So, third chapter is what we're going to talk about, which talks about the risk management approach. Now, the book that I've shared with you that has appendixes, right? So
Okay.
multiple appendices. Now, appendix A essentially gives you the information in terms of the documentation that we do within our risk management area.
Okay.
So documentation like risk management policy, the risk register, the issue register. So multiple documents are created. So information about what it contains is there in the appendix A.
Okay.
So of course this appendix A essentially provides the guidance about how each document's purpose and how an organization might use these to ensure that the risk management is effective. So I can also definitely go ahead and share certain templates with you, which would give you an idea of what information is kept within these documents. So let me show you something first. Okay. So for example, this is the documentation for something called a risk register. Right. And now in a risk register, we essentially document information about all the risks that the organization is facing, or all the risks as a project or a program or operations or whatever we are talking about, in whatever perspective we are talking about, all the information about all the risks is defined within this particular document. So you see there are three files here. There is the cover sheet wherein we can always keep the document that should have name, distributed to, title, date of issue, and version. Then we move into the overview part wherein they give you advice about the risks. So the composition, format, and presentation of the risk register will be derived from the risk management strategy, because that is where we define what should be the possible format and things like that. And then there is other information related to format and presentation, then related to quality criteria. So multiple things that we have to consider while we understand or define the risks. And then the actual document, which is the risk register. Now, in this risk register, we usually have the impact of the inherent risk and impact of the residual risk. So inherent is basically the risk as it is present without any control, and residual is the remaining risk after we have implemented the controls. So what is the impact before and after is what inherent and residual is about. Similarly, probability as well. Probability, what is inherent probability, what is the residual probability after the controls have been defined, after we have put in a risk response plan. There is expected value before and after, for sure. So after we have identified the response plans, what is the residual value that we get, and what was the value before? Similarly, proximity. Proximity is about how soon can a risk happen. So, for example, if I'm doing, let's say, a 1 year long project, so there can be risks which are there in first quarter, second quarter, third quarter, fourth quarter. Right. So when do we expect a particular risk to happen is what is defined based on proximity. Then the risk response categories. So whatever categories that we have, avoid, mitigate, transfer, accept. So for the negative ones, so we define those categories. Out of those categories, which one has been selected is defined in risk response. What is the risk status? If it is still to happen, or if it has been obsolete, if it is in progress, so that status is updated. Risk owner. Now, owner is basically someone who has the overall responsibility for the risk. He or she is the one who makes sure that the risk has been assessed properly based on the right information. Also, they go ahead and make sure that the response plans are available for these risks, right? And that can be implemented. And then there is risk actionee. Now, the only difference between risk owner and risk actionee is that the risk owner is the one who has the overall responsibility of the risk, whereas risk actionee is the one who is responsible for implementing the response plan. Right? So only implementation is what the responsibility of actionee is. So apart from that, all of the things has to be taken care by the risk owner. So that's not just the information that we have here. We have other things as well. Who's the author? What is the date it was registered? What is the category of risk? The cause, event, effect of the risk, and then we move forward. But the key information that we keep in a risk register is the impact, probability, expected value, proximity, risk response categories, and the risk response plans, and who's the owner and who's the actionee. That is what we keep. So do you use risk registers in your organization?
Do I use what now? You're kind of breaking up. Do I use what in my organization?
My question was that do you use risk registers in your organization?
I'm trying to implement some, and just looking at the spreadsheet you got is giving me ideas or something. I'll kind of use myself and adjust it to our organization. So not yet. It just like I said yesterday, a lot of this stuff I'm trying to implement and get put in place. So that's why it is for me. I'm getting a lot of good information from you.
Absolutely. See, this is something which makes the risk management more formalized. It's a more formal way of doing risk management. I'll share this document with you. Okay. This is something that can always be used for doing risk management practically as well. So these are the kind of documents I talk about, or these are all part of my MOR approach, the management of risk approach that I have defined.
Okay.
Now, when it comes to this module, we essentially talk about the MOR approach, which is based on MOR principles. Now, I said this yesterday as well, that principles is something which is the foundation for doing any activity within the organization. So the approach that we develop out of MOR practices, that is also developed based on the approach. The principles. So principles are the foundations, and based on the foundation, we go ahead and define our approach. There are key documents that we have within the MOR approach, out of which we include risk management policy as the first document. Now, policy is basically the intent and the direction of the management. How do they want us to behave within the organization is defined based on the policy. So, for example, my organization had a policy that every trainer should reach the office by 8:30. So by 9, they should be able to start, or they should be able to be ready in terms of start delivering the training. So that was a policy. So that was the intent of the management, or that was the direction of the management that was set. Similarly, for doing risk as well, whatever the management expect us to do is defined within the policy. So that is what they say here as well, that it explains the relevance of risk management and the objectives achieved by implementing a formal risk management approach in an organization. The risk management policy describes why management is important to the organization, and risk management policy is the responsibility of a member of a senior management team within the organization. I hope you know about this, that these policies are always developed at the top level, I mean at the senior management level. That is where we developed it. So the development of these policies are definitely the responsibility of the senior management, and once it has been applied, then it is the responsibility of each individual to follow it. What do we have in a policy? We have introduction, which provide an explanation of the relationship with the other policies. How does it affect any other policies? And describe the benefits of implementing the risk management. So whatever the benefits are, that is also defined in the introduction. The principles and the objectives of risk management and the compliance requirements. So of course, whatever principles that we are using, we usually go ahead and use all the principles which have been defined. So, and what is the objectives that we are using it for, and whatever the compliance requirements are. Risk appetite, risk threshold, and risk capacity. We talked about it yesterday. I mean, review it. Appetite is the willingness of the organization to take the risk. So like I said yesterday, let's say $10,000 is the appetite. Then there is threshold. Threshold is the permissible amount of deviation from the appetite. Right, so $10,000 plus minus 10%. And then there is capacity. Capacity is the maximum amount of risk that I can take. So if I'm talking in terms of the project, then if my project risk goes beyond my capacity, then I can still take a decision to cancel my project or not do it at all, or not pursue it at all. So that's the maximum that I can take. Usually, tolerances and capacities are combined together in order to understand. Then procedure for escalation and delegation. The senior manager will be responsible for either deciding on a course of action or escalating the information to a more senior level. Similarly, it should also be clear when a risk can be delegated to a lower level for the action. So, of course, like we talked about four perspectives yesterday, that there is strategic perspective, there is program perspective, there is project perspective, and then there is operations perspective. But the risks, all these perspectives can definitely cascade to the lower level. So if I have a risk at a strategic level, that can definitely affect my program objective. If we have a risk at a program level, that can always affect my projects. Similarly, if we have a risk at a project level, that can always affect my operations as well. And this goes both ways. It goes top down as well, and it goes bottom up as well. So next is the roles and responsibilities. So like I said, that there are two key roles when it comes to risk management. There is a risk owner, and then there is a risk actually. Owner has the overall responsibility of managing the risk, and actually is only responsible for implementing the response actions or implementing the response plans that we have created. Then we have the risk management process. So the process based on the policy will cross refer to the process that will be adopted in terms of steps in the process and the when it will be applied. So that is what we usually go in create our overall risk management process based on the policies that we have, and because policies is something, like I said, is the intent and direction of the management from the organization. So those policies needs to be referred, and when we refer those policies, we definitely go in fulfill the requirements which have been defined within the policy. Then we have the KPIs and EWIs, the key performance indicators and the early warning indicators. That is also something which is important. Now, for example, if you have logged on to your Gmail account from a new computer or a new device, Gmail or Google sends you an email, right, that you have been logged in from a new device or a new location. That is an early warning indicator that there might be a risk. If you're not the one who has logged in, then you can block your account. Key performance indicators are there in order to measure the performance of the overall risk management within the organization. So that is also what they're defining here, that to be effective, they need to be monitored very regularly, and findings presented in such a way that the information can be quickly assimilated, which means consolidated and shared is what assimilated means, right? So we need to go ahead and monitor the key performance indicators and the early warning indicators on a very frequent basis, so that we can always go ahead and share the information and get to a decision. They also talk about when the risk management should be implemented. They say the degree of risk management activity involved will vary according to the organizational perspective from which the activities are being undertaken. So the four perspectives that we talked about: strategic perspective, program perspective, project and operations perspective. So based on the perspective that we are looking at, we go ahead and implement the activities or the risk management activities which are there. Reporting. This section will describe the purpose and the frequency, structure, and the content of the reports. So how do we actually go ahead and report about the risks that we have identified? So that is one of the key purposes. That is one of the key things. In what format, what information would be there in the risk reports, when the risk reassessment, for example, would be done. So all that kind of information, we put it in a risk report, and then we share it with the concerned people. Then we have the budget. Now, this usually happens in the larger organizations or bigger organizations, wherein they have a separate risk budget. That budget would only be used for the activities which are related to risk management. For example, the risk response plans. So if I've decided to transfer a risk or take an insurance, so it would involve certain cost. So that cost would be taken from the risk budget. If I'm talking about, let's say, installing an antivirus on my employee's computer, that would again bring some cost. So that cost would be taken from the risk budget. So risk budget basically is a separate amount of money which is kept in terms of responding to the risks that we may see. They also define that this section will describe how risk management will be supported across the organization. There are no hard and fast rules to determine the budget for risk management as circumstances vary from organization to organization. Now, if for example, my organization has 500 people working in it, so I may just have a smaller risk budget. Your organization, for example, if they have 100,000 people, then you may just have a larger budget as well. So there is no specific guidelines or there is nothing specific in terms of how to define the risk budget, but it depends on organization and organization basis as to what should be the possible risk